Hi everyone. As you know, I am Lalita, and today my topic is willpower. So what is willpower? Willpower is made up of two words. First is will. Will means desire, ichcha. And second is power. Power means shakti. तो ये दोनों वर्ड जब कंबाइंड होते हैं देन बनता है विल पावर. विल पावर कई चीजें होती है. जैसे हम क्या सोचते हैं कि हमें सपोज दैट हमें वर्कआउट करना है, ठीक है, हमने डिजायर किया, बट वो विल पावर में तब चेंज होता है जब आप उसको मतलब स्ट्रांगली उस चीज को कर पाते हो. लाइक अगर आपने सोचा कि मॉर्निंग में मुझे उठ के वर्कआउट करना है, बट आप सुबह सोते रह गए, तो आपका विल पावर नहीं होगा, वो सिर्फ आपका विल होगा. विल पावर कन्वर्ट होता है तब क्या होता है कि आपको जो नहीं करना होता वो भी आप करने के लिए कैपेबल हो जाते हो. वो आपको इतनी कैपेसिटी देता है, इतनी एनर्जी देता है कि जो भी चैलेंजेस आपके सामने उस सबको आप ओवरकम कर जाते हो. तो विल पावर हमें हेल्प करता है हमारे सक्सेस को अचीव करने में, हमारे गोल को अचीव करने में. So I want to share a story of Arunima Sinha. All you know, Arunima Sinha की story start होती है जब वो 11 अप्रैल 2011 में travel कर रही थी लखनऊ टू दिल्ली. तो क्या हुआ था कि वो ना गोल्ड का चैन पहनी हुई थी, तो उसको उस चैन को छीनने के लिए कुछ रोवर्स आए ट्रेन के अंदर, और जब वो उनसे फाइट करने लगी तो उनको उठा करके ट्रेन से चलती ट्रेन से नीचे फेंक दिए. वो 7 hours रेलवे ट्रैक पे पड़ी रही, पूरे नाइट पड़ी रही. 49 ट्रेन वहां से पास हुई और एक ट्रेन के चपेट में वो आ गई, जिसकी वजह से उनका फ्रैक्चर हो गया. उनका स्पाइनल कॉर्ड में बहुत सारा फ्रैक्चर आया था. उसके अलावा उनका जो लेग था वो डिस्ट्रॉय हो गया कम्प्लीटली. और जब उनको हॉस्पिटल गई तो उनका जो एक लेग था उसमें रॉड डला, और सेकंड लेग जो था उसको आर्टिफिशियल में कन्वर्ट किया गया क्योंकि उसको वो कम्प्लीटली डिस्ट्रॉय हो गया था. जब वो हॉस्पिटल के बेड पे पड़ी हुई थी, सेम टाइम उन्होंने डिसाइड किया कि अगर मुझे न्यू बर्थ मिला है तो गॉड ने कुछ करने के लिए दिया है. तो ऑलरेडी वो वॉलीबॉल प्लेयर थी, उन्होंने सोचा अब मुझे इससे भी बड़ा गेम खेलना है, ऐसा गेम जो कि इतिहास रच दे. फिर उन्होंने सेम टाइम डिसाइड किया कि मुझे माउंटेनियर बनना है और मुझे एवरेस्ट पे चढ़ाई करनी है. तो फिर आफ्टर 4 months जब वो वहां से डिस्चार्ज हुई, वो अपने मिशन को कंप्लीट करने के लिए गई, तो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वो बैजेंद्री पाल से मिली और उनसे गाइडलाइन ली कि कैसे उनको एवरेस्ट पे जाना है. तो सबने उन्हें मना किया कि आप पागल हो गए हो क्या, आपकी आपकी तो कैपेसिटी नहीं है, आपकी बॉडी पूरी डिस्ट्रॉय हो गई है, स्पाइनल कॉर्ड में फ्रैक्चर है, आर्टिफिशियल फुट है, कैसे आप चल पाओगे. लेकिन उन्होंने बोला कि नहीं, मुझे ये करना है. वो आगे बढ़ी, आगे बढ़ते हुए जब वो क्लाइम कर रही थी तब जो स्नो होता है ना, आइस होता है, उसमें जो आर्टिफिशियल लेग्स है वो कंटिन्यू स्लिप हो रहा था. तो वहां भी उन्हें काफी लोगों ने बोला कि ऐसा करो कि आप लौट जाओ, ये आपके बस का नहीं है. तो उन्होंने एक ही आंसर उनको दिया कि ये मेरा लेग है और मुझे पता है कि इसके अंदर कितनी शक्ति है, तो मैं ये करूंगी. फिर उसके बाद जैसे वो आगे बढ़ती, जो डिस्टेंस लोग 3 मिनट में कवर करते थे उस डिस्टेंस को कवर करने में उनको 3 to 4 hours लग जाते थे. वो थोड़ा डिमोटिवेट होती थी, फिर खुद को मोटिवेट करती थी. और उन्होंने उस टाइम पे डिसाइड किया कि सबसे पहले मैं एवरेस्ट पे पहुंचूंगी. और जब 1.5 hours रह गए थे एवरेस्ट में पहुंचने के लिए, तो उनका ऑक्सीजन खत्म हो गया. फिर भी उन्होंने हिम्मत नहीं हारी. उस टाइम पे उन्हें फिर से बोला गया कि आप लौट जाओ, अदरवाइज हो सकता है कि आपकी डेथ हो जाएगी, आप वहां तक नहीं पहुंच पाओगे. तो उन्होंने बोला नहीं, जब मैं अपने गोल के बहुत पास हूं तो मैं रिटर्न नहीं हो सकती, इसके बाद चाहे मेरे साथ जो हो. फिर वो वहां पर गई और सबसे पहले वो एवरेस्ट पे पहुंची और वहां पे फ्लैग होस्ट की. तो उन्होंने बताया कि हैंडीकैप इंसान बॉडी से नहीं होता है, माइंड से होता है. और किसी इंसान का बॉडी कितना भी अच्छा हो, अगर वो माइंड से हैंडीकैप है तो कभी भी आगे नहीं बढ़ सकता, वो कभी कुछ भी नहीं कर सकता. तो वो कहती है कि मेक योर वीकनेस योर स्ट्रेंथ, अपनी वीकनेस, जो भी वीकनेस है उसको अपना स्ट्रेंथ बनाओ एंड नेवर गिव अप. कभी आप अपने टारगेट को छोड़ो नहीं. नेक्स्ट, एवरीथिंग इज इन योर माइंड. हर चीज आपके माइंड में है. आपकी बॉडी आपकी वीकनेस नहीं, आपका माइंड है, तो माइंड को कंट्रोल करो. एंड बी योर ओन मोटिवेशन, क्योंकि बाहर वाले आपको मोटिवेट करने नहीं आएंगे, या बाहर वाले चाहे आपको जितना भी मोटिवेट करें, जब तक आपके अंदर मोटिवेशन नहीं है, बाहर चाहे कुछ भी हो, आपको कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ेगा. एंड नेक्स्ट, टेक रिस्क इन लाइफ. बिना लाइफ में रिस्क के लिए आप कुछ नहीं कर सकते. अगर आप कंफर्ट जोन को नहीं छोड़ोगे तो आप आगे नहीं बढ़ पाओगे. डोंट सेटल, मेक न्यू गोल्स. सो दीज ऑल थिंग्स फ्रॉम माय साइड फॉर टुडे. थैंक यू किरण.
वाओ, अमेजिंग ललिता जी, बहुत ही अच्छा अपना स्टोरी बता के बाद में आपके समरी निकाल के पॉइंट्स भी बता दिए. सुपरबली सुपरबली शेयर्ड ललिता जी, वेरी नाइस. इनफैक्ट द वन थिंग आई लाइक्ड अबाउट ललिता जी इज द एनर्जी एंड द एक्सप्रेसिवनेस शी शेयर्स अबाउट द स्टोरीज एंड टॉपिक. इट्स रियली नाइस. कीप गोइंग ललिता जी. थैंक यू सो मच फॉर शेयरिंग.
थैंक यू किरण.
विल मूव टू द नेक्स्ट स्पीकर देन. भूषण, यू आर ऑनलाइन. भूषण,
यस किरण,
आई विल स्पॉटलाइट यू.
Okay, I need to speak up.
Yep, you are spotlight.
Okay, hi everyone. Myself Bhushan, and today my topic is about why self growth is important. So, what is the self growth actually? Self growth in the sense self development, like effective communication skills, leadership skill, how to handle the negativity, how to handle the team. So it's all kind of so it's a collection of so many things that is called self growth. So self growth, what in 2019 what I have learned and how much I've grown compared to 2020. If my growth is the same as 2029 and 2020, it means I have not grown. It means I work with same experience and say multiple years with same knowledge and same experience. That is the thing actually. And so we have to focus on our self-development, because our self-development and internal growth is only define our external value. Whatever successful people are there, not because of the how much they have money or position, it is because of their internal growth, and they have grown day by day, year by year. Same thing in our for it's apply for all of us, okay? But sometimes we confuse. We think that self growth will happen automatically, but it is not like that. Let's take example. Let's say I have started my career and job, and I thought ki why this self growth is important. So many, my manager told, and other people also told, we have to grow. But I never took seriously. I thought ki self growth will be it will happen automatically year by year, but after some time I realized I have so many weakness. I don't have the proper communication skill, I don't have the proper public speaking skill, and how so many weakness I had. So I joined this book club. For example, I joined this book club, and since 2 years I have associated with the book club and the PIM session. And slowly, I have grown. In 2 years, I can see my difference in my skills and myself. And before 2 years and within 2 years, I can see and that confidence what I got it because of the self growth. Slowly, I have grown. So in the same way, we have to, so it is, self growth is depends how your self growth is will happen within 2 years or 5 years. It's based on only how much how many books you read and the people who are associated with the peoples. Here, I am associated with the people who believe on the growth, and that's why I have learned from them and I have grown myself. In the same way, if we want to grow ourselves and self-development, we have to go through some books, and we have to associate with the people who believe in the self-growth, and then can we learn. So this is the very, very important. It is my own experience, how much I learn and grow. And sometimes people have the confusion, illusion ki, self-development will happen. So self-development and self-growth will happen intentionally. It will not happen automatically. So it is very, very important for our personal and professional life also. Sometimes we feel ki jab koi karega, jab wo time aega, to main kar lunga. But aisa hota nahi hai. Jab hum karenge, tab wo time aega. So that's the self-growth is very, very important. Thank you very much. Take it seriously. And this book club and BIM session is the wonderful and amazing. People who are believing in the self-growth, they come and they learn and inspire and contribute us. So thank you very much. Keep learning, keep growing.
Thank you so much, Bhushan. Thank you so much. The reason I gave Bhushan this topic is out of a reason, because he is a life testimony of self-growth. Most of you have not seen Bhushan, I think, 1 or 2 years back. But the power of consistency and power of compounding always works. We generally feel ki agar hum log daily agar nahi kar payenge to kyun kare? But actually, even if you can't do daily, weekly twice, if you do for 2 years, just count. Weekly twice is 2, in a month is 10, and 10 into 12 is 120 times. And 120 times into 2, the 240 times. 240 times if you speak and be prepared, then nobody can stop you of growing. And that multiply into 10 more, 5 more years, that's it. 2000, 3000, you'll hit that 10,000 hours also. And that is when, after 5 years, when someone sees Bhushan ki, oh, Bhushan, you're so nice, you speak so fluently, oh, you can, you know, mesmerize the audience and all, then Bhushan will be thinking from his, you know, mind, ye to tumko pata nahi maine kitne papad bele hain, aapne dekha nahi hai. Log mere pe haste the pehle, people used to laugh at me, people used to criticize me, people used to make fun of me, but that time, you know, most of you were not there. But now when you see me, you know, growing, now you think it is talent. Nothing is talent. It comes out of consistent effort. So thank you so much, Bhushan, for sharing this topic. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderfully shared. Great. So we'll quickly move for the.
So imagine Amazon or Google was not there. What would have been with our life? Most of us might have been without job, or most of us would buy stuff like the old way, traditional way. Assuming Flipkart is also not there. So what is the common theme between all these unicorns like Amazon, Flipkart, or Apple, Google? So they have built platforms or systems that have made them scalable like exponentially. Google can add a search query with no extra cost. Amazon can onboard a new product with minimal or no, zero, near to zero cost. So they have developed, they have invested in building systems, and the systems build the company. What if we apply the same thing to our life? Can we build some systems for ourselves? And how, why, those I will cover in this next 3 minutes. That is called Law of Design, which I have taken from the book, The 15 Laws of Growth by John Maxwell. So why we need systems? Our life is very simple actually, but we keep forgetting things because we have to achieve a lot of things. Like in Wheel of Life, we have to balance all the 8 spokes of the wheel, like our career, family life, health, everything, right? But we need to juggle between all these 3. So that way the difficulty arises. Okay. So how to solve that? So we have to know what are our values. Then based on our values, we need to have some decisions, and we need to manage those decisions on a daily basis. But here comes the problem. Managing those decisions on a daily basis is tough because we are too much distracted by different external stimuli, right? So we need to then how to solve it then. We understand the problem that we cannot manage everything systematically in the same way, simple way, every day. There should be something we need help of, which can simplify that. So that's where we need a system which can help us in planning our life on a daily basis to manage and to achieve our goals. Let me share some so if I show you few applications like PureFit, Fitbit, Daily Planner or Time Planner, Money Management, what is the common theme between these? These applications help you manage your goals, financial goals or health goals systematically, right? So you can apply these on a day-to-day basis to track our daily goals, which will help us in achieving our, these are systems. So what if we apply these systems on a daily basis to our life? So what a system should look like to help us achieve our goals? That is covered by covered in the book in a very detailed way. Systems, what is the benefit of system? System permit ordinary people to achieve extraordinary results predictably. There won't be any surprises at the end of our life. And it is a process for predictively achieving our goals on some specific, orderly or repeatable practices. Without system, every task we have to start from scratch. So design systems for each area of your life, like the previous examples. You can reuse some of the existing system, or if it is not there, you can build a simple system. It might not be a software system. It can be a simple notepad or simple spreadsheet also. So system should have below attributes. It should be action bias. It should not be only on paper. Every system should trigger an action for you. Then B. So there is an acronym ABCMNOP. A is for action bias. B is for big picture. Each system should connect to a big picture or big goal of your life. C, it should be consistent, which can be applied on a daily, weekly, yearly basis throughout your life. It should be measurable in numbers. So without measurement, we cannot know where we are going. So it should be, it is easy to track and adjust our schedule based on the feedback that we get when we measure, when the system is measurable. And it should help you organize our time. Because why time? Why not money? Because money once lost can be earned again, but time once lost, gone forever. That's why time is more critical, and a good system helps you organize your time. And last is priority. So given that we have to juggle between a lot of priorities on a day-to-day basis, effective systems should help you set the priorities and in their order. So those are the attributes a good system should have. Those you can use to choose a good system which will help achieve your goals. These are the parameters we can use. Now, why, given that we use these systems, what will happen? So once you invest time to using or building a system, then the system will build you. And what do you want? Given that we are 2020, we are whatever state we are, and 2030, we have a vision for ourselves, right? So the system that we will build will make the vision into conclusive phase by 2030, whatever the time limit you have. So it will help you to reach from goal A, point A to point B in a given time frame in a systematic and predictable way. So let's take advantage of the system. Let's learn from the smartest companies of the world and apply them to our life. We have the real world examples just to copy and replicate. What else we need? Thank you.
Wonderful, Jiju. Very concentrated and very, very beautiful talk, because the book which he is covering is Vijay has taken the first module, 15 Laws of Growth. Almost every session, Vijay has covered one law for almost 1 hour. And we are just going through recap. We are just recapping whatever Vijay has taught, and Jiju is doing wonderful job. I think he covered 4 or 5 laws. Jiju, how many laws you have covered already? This is law of design.
6 laws I have covered.
six laws are covered. So more five and six, I think six more, nahin. Eight, nine more laws are there. So the whole laws are like Bible of your life. So the book is amazing. And you know, if in case you want to want a shortcut, it won't be a shortcut though. You can probably get Vijay's recording as well, and you can go through them as well. Great. So we'll move to the next speaker. Ishwar, you're online.
Yes, Kiran.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Good evening to everyone. Today my topic is ESBI, written by Robert Kiyosaki. The main learnings in this book I got things are ESBI means employee, small business, and big business and investor. In this book, this book name is called Cash Flow Quadrant. In this book, Robert Kiyosaki explained about the topic of ESBI, and he divided the ESBI book into two parts, quadrant one and quadrant two. In quadrant one, he will tell about the employee and the small business. In quadrant two, he will explain about the big business and the investor. In that book, he explained that what is the difference between the quadrant one and quadrant two. Which who on our people will come under quadrant one, who on our people will come under quadrant two. First one is employee, and second one is small business, and third one is big business, and the fourth one is investors. The part one people are small business and employee. The small business and employee people are if this part one people, if they want to GDP growth for the part one people is around 3%, and the GDP growth around the part one part two people will be around 3%. Means for Indian economy, this part two people are growing very less. Part two people are giving very less, 3%, but the part one people are giving very high, 97%. So people also consider both 97% in part one only, and part two only 3%. But the growth, if you compare that one, part two people are giving too much income to the Indian economy, 3%. But the part two people around 97, part one people are around 97% there, but the growth they are giving to Indian economy is very less, around 3%. If you compare both, the difference means in India, in world, total world, only part one people are giving less growth to to Indian economy. That is at the rate of 97%. But part two people are less 3%, but they are giving around 97% to the Indian economy. These things and I learned. And one more thing, the major difference between the part one and part two is the people's mindset, how they will think, they will do the work. The major difference between the part one and part two is these part one people will focus only on security, and they will not take any risk. And the part two people will focus on freedom. And and one more difference is these people will focus on money, and part two people, they will focus on wealth. And these people will focus on instant gratification, that they will not risk more, and they want money instantly, monthly wages. And the part two people, they will focus on delayed gratification. If it is taking too much also, they will wait for some time, and they will get the money back. And one more thing is traders. These people are part one people are traders, and the part two people are leveragers, and they will leverage the time. These people will not leverage the time, but part two people will leverage the time. And part one people, they will think every time how we have to do, from whom help, for help, how I will get the help from other people, they will think. And part two people, they will not think how, and they will think why I want to do, they will think. These part one people and part two people, so many differences will be there. Around those differences, I categorize these five differences. These are the major five differences. Here, part one people in the sense, employee people and small business people. And part two means business people and investment people. This is a topic of ESBI, that if I want to summarize, means part one people will cover under only, part one people will be only 97%, but giving the economy to India, to world, is only 3% of the growth. But part two people, around 3% will be there in world, but they are giving the growth to Indian economies 97%. This is the main differences that he explained in ASBI. Thank you.
Very nicely covered, Ishwar. I think the content what you were sharing was very, very deep. I think while you were... This is the image which I think is a, my screen is visible, right?
Yeah, right now.
Yes.
So if you, I think this is what you're talking, right? If I'm not wrong, just to help you out.
Yes.
People who are new, this is what Ishwar was talking about. It's Cash Flow Quadrant is a book name. And the content which you were sharing is pretty deep. So once you read it, once you really breathe and sink in, all else you won't understand. So it's a very good content. Thank you so much, Ishwar, for sharing. We'll move next. Okay. Just a second. Shiva, is your bandwidth fine? Do you want to speak? Shiva Kumar. Shiva, if you can hear me.
Topic from the magic of thinking big, that is how to turn defeat into victory. Okay. So, I just wanted to share one my experience when I started my engineering diploma first year. So I completed my schooling from the Marathi medium, so Maharashtrian, so Marathi medium. So all the subjects in Marathi except English language. So which started from the fifth standard. Okay, in the fifth standard we were learning A, B, C, D from the fifth standard only. So in the 5 years we learn. So we can just read the English, but not that much understand the English in the 5 years only. So suddenly I started my engineering diploma and in the first semester, in the first 6 months, I still remember. So in the physics, I got 6 out of 100 marks. Okay. So at that time, everyone was like scolding me in my family, my friends. That you were the smart person or sharpest person in the 10th class. So why, what happened to you that you could not get much more marks, or you could not pass, at least pass the that exam, the physics exam in the diploma engineering first year. Okay, so that was the biggest setback for me. So then at that time, what I did is that, so I tried to understand what exactly wrong happened with me. So till 10th standard, I was just mugging up the things, and I was just before the night of the exam, I was just mugging up the things and I was writing in the paper. Okay, but since I started my engineering diploma, everything was in the English language. I could not mug it up. Okay, so I just understood that mugging will not help me. But I need to find out some other way that so I can get successful, or I will pass into these exams which are in the English language. So what I started doing is that I am not on the only one person at the first time who is going from Marathi medium to English medium engineering diploma. There are many people who did this before as well. So I meet many of the people, my seniors in the diploma engineering as well as bachelor of engineering who studied them. I talk with them, and they just explain me that whatever you are going through, the same thing we went through. Okay. So what you need to do is that instead of mugging up, you just need to understand what that particular concept is saying. And you just try to write in the exam in your own language. That is what you want to do. Okay, so when I completed my first year of diploma engineering, I was one of the person who got first class out of my, in the first year itself, with all the subjects clear out. Okay, so what I did at that time is that, so I got the very less marks. I failed at the first point of time, but I didn't stop there. I studied my setbacks. Is what happened exactly. Okay, what happened exactly? You share your failures with other people that this is what happened. What should I do? Then what I did is that instead of blaming that I am from the Marathi medium, I could not study in English medium. I just researched my what I can do, and I just tried my tried my things so that I can get the success. And I did it persistently every time. Means I did it for the first year. I did it means, for example, I was studying 8 hours a day just by looking into the dictionaries. Means if I could not understand any English language, I was just taking, I remember that person, S.P. Soni, English language, Marathi, English Marathi dictionary was there. I was just keeping it beside and I was reading and understanding each English word and looking the Marathi Marathi meaning out of it. Okay. And so this way I tried to turn my defeat into victory. So what I did, so there are 4 points basically we need to do in terms how to turn in defeat into victory is that study your setbacks. Don't, when you lose, learn and then go on to the next time winning. Then have courage to be your constructive critic. Means whatever you failure, accept that and try to overcome over those failures. Stop blaming luck. Research whatever setback you got. Because blaming anyone, blaming anything will not help you anymore. You will not get anything out of constructive out of blaming. Instead of try to research what is the cause of failure and try to work on that cause which because of which you failed, and then do it consistently. So these are the 4 things you need to do in term to turn the defeat into victory. So that's all from my side. Thank you very much.
Superb Prakash.
Okay, so hi all. So today I am going to speak about last but once topic of Vijay's workshop of PIM, that is how you have to be an action oriented person. Okay, so I think we had beautiful topics till now. So I'll just share my screen. Kiran, I hope you are able to see my screen.
Yes.
Yeah, so I think Vijay beautifully covered. I do my best covering some of the important points. And what he says is, first thing is, everything worthwhile is uphill. Okay, so many of us have uphill dreams, but downhill habits. You take anything like, for example, health. If you want to reduce some of your weight, you have to put extra effort to reduce. But if you want to increase your weight, you need not put any effort, right? Except eating. And if you want to improve your money, if you have to grow in your career, you have to put extra effort. You have to put so much of extra dedication. But if you don't want to grow, if you can keep doing the same work, that is fine. Okay. Similarly, this formula applies for everything, like relationship. If you want to grow in your relationship, or if you want to improve your self-respect, self-moral, or you want to do something which purposefully, which is good, or to be aimless, it doesn't take anything. But you have to live a purposeful living. It takes uphill. Everything is uphill. Okay. Start working before you know how to achieve the vision. So a lot of us, sometimes we, if you want to do something, we will stop ourselves saying, because, okay, I don't want to do this because I want to do this, but I'm not a because. So this because, right, you have to delete it from the dictionary. And stop doing only those things you were doing it before, and start doing those things you could do and you should do. I'll just repeat, stop doing only those things you were doing it before, and start doing those things you could do and you should do. Okay, I hope you got it. It's self-explanatory. And stop doing important things occasionally and start doing important things daily. I'll repeat again. Stop doing important things occasionally and start doing important things daily. Okay, so these are some of the important points to reach uphill dreams. And how to take action now. So he gives a beautiful statement. Life is like a great big canvas, and you should throw all the paint. You should throw all the paints on it that you can. I'll just repeat. Life is like a great big canvas, and you should throw all the paints on it that you can. Okay. So if you want to do job, if you want to spend nice time with family, kids, if you want to watch cricket, you want to watch movie, you want to achieve success, everything is, if you want to throw it on the canvas, it will be difficult, right? So he tells you, do an effectiveness audit. Okay, top 5 things, list down top 5 things which you have to do towards where you want to go. Okay, like daily, on a daily basis, like you have to spend some time with family. Yes, you have to do your job. Yes, I think if I take my case, I want to participate in the book club, I have to read some books and prepare the content. That also I have to do it daily, at least half an hour. If you take Vijay, he's a life coach. He prepares 3 to 4 hours every day. Okay, so like this, do some top five things which you have to do daily. Other things you can delegate it. And this is one important thing which I wanted to cover, which Vijay covered. This is called sigmoid curve. I hope you have seen this curve. I'm not sure. So if you see, we started our career at the age of 22, right? 22, 23, we start earning 20,000 or 30,000. But we would have invested so much of money. If you ask your parents, they will tell how much they invested to make that. So initial few years, if you see, the growth will be good. But if you see later, at some point of time, we will definitely hit some uncertainty, because life will definitely throw challenges to us, right? So when you go down, right, from A to B, and during that time, if you want to do something, that will be difficult, because you will be down with energy and down mentally also. And to start something new or to acquire some new skills, it will be very difficult for you. So what Vijay tells is, you do something which is you need it later when you don't need it. Okay. If you see, when the curve is growing up and when you start some new skills, it will take some time for you to get better at it. So, okay. So this is very important, and this has very deep meaning. Just try to understand this. I hope you got this point. And in summary, a man was on the 30th floor of a fancy hotel overlooking Central Park in Manhattan. He pulled back the shades and threw open the window to enjoy the view. As he leaned out of the window, he was startled to see a man falling past his window. "How are you doing?" he asked the falling man. "Fine so far," came the reply. The point is, doing just fine. The point is, he's doing just fine, but he can't stay in the free fall forever. Sooner or later, he will meet the ground. Okay. So I hope you got the point. We'll just dig the well when we are not thirsty, so that we'll get the water when we need it. Okay. So I think this is what I wanted to share, Kiran. Thank you.
Amazing. Karthik, as usual, you know, you bring your topic with your presentation, a unique style, and many people copy your style as well, but it's very nice. In fact, the line you started with, I think most of us, we aspire to go uphill, but our habits are like downhill. So easy to relate, and very, very deep thought. Superbly covered. Yes. Thank you so much, Karthik. So we'll move to the next speaker. I think we have our invited speaker with us. His name is Amit. Amit ko almost, I have known him almost one and a half, two years now. And he's I am Lucknow alumni, and very, very successful in corporate. I think he has more than 15 plus year experience, and pretty good at when it comes to heading teams, and very strong speaker. Personally, I have listened to him a lot of time. He's point to point, and he's a very strong speaker. So I won't delay much. Amit bhai, the stage is yours. I spotlighted you.
Yeah. Hi, Kiran. Good evening, everyone. Many thanks, Kiran, for the awesome introduction. So without delaying further, let me start. So I did my, post-grad from IIM Lucknow. And my journey, if I talk about that, my schooling had been from Delhi. And then post that, I did hotel management. So totally, I carry, 15 years of experience today. And based out of Bangalore corporate office, working with a retail firm at a, at a senior level. So, I did my schooling from Delhi, and then, post that I did my hotel management, and then my career started, from Delhi. And with my family background, if I talk about, my father is engineer, my sister engineer, and my cousins are engineer. You talk about Tacha, Mama, Tau, everyone is engineer, right? So I was the one odd man out, right? So it was like, it was never like that I hated engineering, right? But what happened when I was looking at my father, being a civil engineer, going to the sites, going on the, construction buildings, visiting, coming back with all the dust, mud, and then I felt like, boss, I mean, aisa hi hota hai kya? Is this engineering like all about? And then, okay, I do not want to do that, right? Hence I chosen to be different, right? And then what different was hotel management, and hotel, the moment you think about what comes to your mind, luxury, right? Somebody will open the door for you, right? I mean, you have a big car, flashy outshines, attire and all that, but not, right? So the moment hotel comes, it's like you are living a luxurious life, right? Isn't it? You're living the suite rooms and all that, whatnot. However, So when I did hotel management, right? So during the program, I'm sure some of you must be aware about that you go through the internship programs, right? And during those internship programs, you know, I got to know a couple of, you know, five-star properties, and then, you know, working very closely with those industries and then understanding that how the industry moves. And then I realized, boss, that, you know, what I had thought initially, is that the real world? Actually, no, you know, rather than somebody's opening door for me, maybe I have to open doors for someone else, right? And then my myth, you know, was busted, right? So it's like, you know, something which is so-called that, you know, I was looking for a status quo was, you know, mismatching, to be honest, right? And then what happens, though, since it was my decision to, you know, carry on with the journey of hotel management, I did it. But though got a campus placement, you know, at a decent organization, started off also, but what was happening, at the end of second year, I was very clear that I think I would not want to be lifelong, you know, in this industry. And I have had something so-called a burning desire that I have to go on for something else. But what, to be honest, was not clear. And then what was happening? By the third year, I had started preparing and thinking about that I'll go for MBA, right? So a virus came in my mind that, okay, if not this, you know, how about going for the further studies and, you know, higher studies, and that's next, what is that? That's an MBA. And since that virus was again, that I have to be different. So then MBA also do not have to be from any regular college, right? It has to be from a different institute. So I actually started preparing, you know, day and night with respect to my CAT exams. Was it true? Actually, no. You know, at the end of the fourth year, no, not that point. Fine. And so college was finished, campus placement got, but was I excited about the journey, you know, to start with the hotel industry? Actually, no, as I just shared, right? So then what happened? And then I quit even that job, right? And so no man's land, like, I mean, you know, after completion of your degree program. And what happened by that time, my father, being a class one officer, got a promotional transfer to another city. And then by that time, we had shifted to another city. And then it was like, you know, sense of responsibility came in that, boss, do I really need to leave my, you know, sibling, my sister and my mom, and then go to another city for MBA or something like that? I thought, okay, let it be like that, you know, maybe next time. And then I started off look for a job and opportunity, and then started off with the McDonald's. You know, by that time, it was one of the premium, you know, organizations to start up the journey. And so started a management training and then moved on. And then what happened after 2 years again, I had that boredom that, boss, what is happening? You know, this is what I thought. And then the pop-up of this, you know, MBA again, you know, woke up. And then I thought, okay, since that was again happening in my life, then I thought, okay, opportunity came in from a retail industry. You know, that was an industry which was booming up by that time. Like in engineering, it happened more in computer science or EC and all that. So that industry, you know, as a retail industry came in. I was all ready to take that risk and jump, to be very honest. Though, because I had that burning desire, you know, to move on. And I was really finding for something which was really different. And then started off with retail, understanding the industry completely. And then after 2 years, again, that boredom came in, that, you know, points, you know, in my life that, okay, is that what I was looking for? So that question was always hovering around in the mind, always there, right? And since I was into that, you know, looking zone, looking forward for the growth, that became my job. So what happened? Another job came in. I picked up that thought and thinking about that, maybe I'll find my happiness there, you know? And then by the time I completed 5 years, and then I thought, boss, I think this is again, like, I'm looking forward for a mirage, you know, that your happiness is there, career is there, and I'm looking forward for it. The moment I reach over there, I mean, it's nothing, you know, absolutely nothing there. Now, I thought, okay, let me let everything, you know, keep aside. And then how about I actually go, pack my bags, study hard, work hard, and then actually get, you know, the MBA done. So then that's how, again, my previous preparations of CAT helped me. Again, restarted preparing, and then, you know, got you know, admission in IIM. And then once I was through with that, then did it help me? Yes, it helped me, no doubt, right? But when I came back, so they say, you know, that the great power comes with a great electricity bill, right? So you know, same thing happened over here. You know, at the corporate level, when you're working at a you know, good senior level, the great responsibility comes with a great fatty expectations, right? But it does not come with the expectation of 9-to-5 job which I had been looking forward for. You know, Saturday, Sunday is completely packed and fun-filled, you know, life with the family. That was not the case. It was all opposite. And then I started thinking of boss. I had been looking forward for something else, but you know, this is not that. And then what was happening was working, you know, traveling to multiple cities because the job roles and different departments, stress started coming in. You know, it started taking, you know, a toll on my health, to be honest. And then I started realizing, boss, this is something is wrong, you know, in my life, because I invested my time, money and effort, not at the cost of there is no time for family, not at the cost of there is no time for kids. You know, you got married to someone, there is someone in your life, and then it's not that you are there 24/7, but at least some quality time, you know, because after all these expectations, you know, you just cannot say, okay, I'm done for the day, right? And what's my wages for that day? Give it to them, and back, you know, and back to home. However, what happened then? You know, slowly, gradually, then I started realizing that something is really, you know, wrong. Maybe I did not had a good end to begin with, right? So what I'm trying to say, I did not begin with the end in my mind. So I was looking forward for a good career growth, money and all that, but it did not help me, to be honest, right? And then, you know, I shifted to Bangalore. And then by the time my kid was, you know, 3 years and 3.5. And then I saw one day that if I have to plan his life, what will I do? Do I need to invest in mutual funds? Do I need to buy some equities and keep it aside? You know, beta bada ho jayega to spend cash kara lega. Do I need to buy certain properties and then, you know, it will help him in terms of monetary benefits and all that? But is that the real planning life? By now I realize that money is not the real happiness, right? And then I thought, one day, in fact, he asked me, like, Papa, I want to learn swimming. Then I thought, okay, couple of answers can be given, right? One, beta bada ho jayega to apne aap seekh lega na, school jayega to seekh lega na, and all that, you know. So when the right time will come, you know, it will happen by default, is what I'm trying to say. But then I thought, okay, good that I have developed a bonding and a relationship and an openness with him, you know, irrespective of the age. And he has openly come to me and then asked that, you know, this is what I want to learn. So as a, can I play a role of a mentor? You know, these were thoughts which was in my mind. And then I thought, okay, what do I really need to do as a father or as a friend or as a coach or as a counselor? I need to really get him enrolled to the right platform, which is the swimming pool, right? Which is the coach, right? Where I need to get him enrolled. And so that he could be in the environment, right environment, learn the swimming and then move on. So that once he has learned that, from there on, then, you know, he can find out his passion. And then here, there on, he can move to the next level, right? With respect to either swimming or maybe something else. But at least taking the right step at the right time, that all starts with the right decision, isn't it? One. Two, then the word mentor came to my mind. You know, as I told you, I was always into the looking zone. And thank God that I was always been like, you know, have never been into the comfortable zone. I've never been into comfortable. You can always just see that, you know, in my background, from hotel management to MBA, then again to retail industry and whatnot, right? And I was always looking forward to take any risk. You know, when I say any risk, it's like even switching over to the industries, of course. I mean, you know, because once your risks are clear, then you know that, you know, you can manage it, you have the confidence, you can do it. But what am I supposed to do? I mean, at the end of the day, if that is what something, you know, I'm looking forward for, I think by that time, my mind was clear that I'm not on a right track, you know, something is missing. And then they say, you know, that when you are into a looking zone, you know, God also helps you, right? And then I really found this organization, you know, Peak Impact Mentorship, got connected to Vijay. And then, you know, since I was very much open and I was into the looking zone, you know, I really shared everything with respect to what I was going through in my life. And, you know, when I looked at him, the person, you know, carrying a, again, you know, tremendous amount of experience, as we all know, in fact, about Mr. Vijay, you know, coming from an IIT, you know, background, you know, again, a postgrad from IIT, somebody so is so humble, you know, inspiring millions of people. And the when I spoke to him, you know, he really found me, he really helped me in terms of finding my passion. And then I thought, boss, I think this is something, you know, if not only me, you know, everyone, each one of my friend, relative, should really know about that, you know, we should not only look after and go after the money, right? I'm sure, you know, we have read, all of us, we have read, you know, in Robert Kiyosaki book, that if you work for money, you know, you will settle for less, right? And so many philosophies has been given with respect to different thought processes of rich dad versus poor dad and whatnot, right? And since I was into the looking zone, thank God that I found the right mentor with the help of Peak Impact Mentorship. And we all know about him, right? And what it has really helped me in terms of, you know, finding out my right passion. You know why? Because the kind of life, you know, which we want to live, if we discover the why part, I think, you know, will be true, right? One. Two, I also started understanding. In fact, I would say if some of you or any one of you starting, you know, connecting with my story, because this is my journey, right? My part of the life. That I can only say as a sincere advice to one and all over here is to think through your life very, very carefully, right? You know, it's about the entire life, you know, rather than asking a simple question that I want to make this much of money, rather than what if I just tweak my question and then ask and then say to myself that I want to live this kind of life so that I have the, you know, a peace, right? A happiness, money, right? Work-life balance, right? Not only the money and which is only giving the stress. And because of this stress, I'm losing out everything, you know, with respect to my health, with respect to my no time with family and friends. There's no social life, you know, completely neglected. So what do I have to choose, right? I have to choose a perfect balanced life. I think that should be the thought in my mind. And hence, I started asking myself after meeting Vijay and the, you know, beautiful people in this beautiful association that what kind of life I wanted to live. Because I never thought that if I'll be chasing money, you know, I'll not be getting, you know, the happiness and other stuff. But I think opposite happened, right? And trust me, friends, I can only say that, you know, let's have this strong burning desire. Yes, no doubt, we all have to grow, right? But let's understand that, you know, how a person who is living that kind of life can really help us, right? As I told to you that my kid, he wanted to learn swimming, right? What if I would have just ignored his question, would not have understand about his likes and dislikes, then would he be able to share, you know, other things, other stuffs in his life going forward? Actually, no, right? So rather than the age, rather than even though I do not have time, I broke that and I thought, okay, what it really matters is creating the right environment to grow, right? And that way I can develop the friendship bonding with my you know, kid, and eventually I can be a true mentor to him where he could share openly with me and then I could transform his life with right questions asked and showing him the right path rather than asking him to chase money, right? And ultimately, right, you know, I would only say and end my talk and conclude my talk over here that, see, if you have found your passion, I mean, you know, amazing. If it's still not, let's understand that, you know, help the other person, you know, your mentor, the person who is living that kind of life, to identify the passion in you, right? Because the passion helps you, you know, to make a difference because you are doing something that you find valuable, right? Those who are most successful, you know, will happily tell others that how much they love what they do. And that's what makes a difference in the life, right? And passion, you know, passion is really the fuel which will always keep you on the path towards, you know, realizing the goals and achieving your dreams, isn't it? So friends, at the end, I would only say that let's have a clear roadmap, you know, a very clear, crystal clear vision about their life. And at the end, why not to restart our life with a simple question of why, you know, why am I doing it? Why? And that's it, you know. So thank you, Kiran, and thank you, everyone, you know, for listening.
We are really honored, Amit, really, really honored and really value your time to come and share piece of your life, because that is not that easy to, I know previously you were with Akshay Seema's book club. In fact, Amit was just before he came to our book club, he was with Akshay Seema. He spoke there, he shared his story with them, then again ran and came, just quickly came here with no time of gap as such, and sharing with us all his heart is truly amazing. So before, you know, before we end, we want one culture to, you know, we want to duplicate one culture. So culture is that any one person, before 30 seconds gone, please unmute yourself and share one learning which you learned and which you'll be implementing. Quick, who will share?
Shall I say?
Yeah, sure.
A
And the most important thing is what he said is like never quitting for anything, like not a quitter mindset. Life is full of struggle, all of us have, and with that struggle we should never quit, and we have to find our way to get it, get the success. So always there is a way to get the success, and we need to find out the proper way and proper method, and that again the specialized knowledge people we need to find out so that we can make our life better.
Thank you.
Wonderful, Amitji. I hope you felt special. Amitji, keep coming.
Thank you, Amitji.
Your experience will really add a lot of value. I'm sure with your story, many people would have related, because, you know, as Vijay used to say, wise man is someone who will learn from people's experience and implement it. But a foolish man is someone who doesn't apply to listen. That is a foolish guy. But then, yeah, we will apply a few of the learnings and definitely give you a lot of updates, Amit bhai. Thank you so much for sharing your
story. Many thanks, Kiran. Thanks a ton, everyone here, for listening my story. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. Thanks.
Cool. So we'll move to the next speaker. Chachu, you can go ahead. We'll go with Chachu's talk.
Okay, good. So, friends, I'm Dilip Gupta. I'm connecting from Pune, and I have a experience about 17 years, and I'm carrying an IT career. And almost it's about 20 years, and out of those 17 years and IT experience, and I always inspire about the leadership, right? I always inspired from the beginning itself, and you know, somewhere or other in our life, we want to be a leader, and whether you want or not, you are a leader. If you may not be realizing that if you are you have a home team. In the home team also, you are a leader, right? And you have your kids or your spouse. So sometimes the lady lead the home, and sometimes the husband lead the home. So, and if you're working somewhere, then you're definitely leading a project or somewhere in the company. And also each and every respect, somewhere or other we are leading. So what if you are leader, if you feel yourself is a leader, then there must be someone or some people must be following you. So without a follower, you cannot be a leader, right? So what are the attributes of a leadership, good leadership should have? I just wanted to share my screen, Kiran. I'll tell you about a few of the points about leadership, attributes of leadership, major attributes. So let's talk about unwavering courage. So without when you call yourself as a leader, you need to have the subject knowledge, whatever be the subject, whether it's about home, managing your home, or managing a team, or managing a project, something like that. So definitely there is, you need to have a broad knowledge, experience, you need to have, and without that you cannot lead a team. Self-control. What it says, talks about self-control. Suppose if I have a home team, if I my kids are reading, and if I watch TV, because I'm not able to control, and after the day's work, I came home and I started watching TV. What will happen to the people, the kids, and like that? So each and every in every respect, we need to have a self-control. What time and what we need to do, we should do. Not that what we want at that particular period of time. Okay. And sense of, when you say the sense of justice, if you have a team and if you are not able to provide them the justice, and if you are biased, and then what will happen? You the followers will not follow you. Okay. Likewise, if you are a leader, then you will have some plan. So all the leaders always plan their work and work upon their plan. Okay. The next is having habit of doing more than paid for. You know, we have a life example of Vijay, our mentor, and Kiran, and Bharat, and so these people, like whoever is leading a particular activity or a particular team of people, always they see that how can I give more. They don't, whatever they paid, because if I can say about book club, we are not paying anything to Kiran, but generously Kiran is providing all the support to all the people who are part of this book club to grow. Vijay, if you talk about Vijay, we are giving just 100 rupees in a week to gain some knowledge from him, from his own experience. But is it enough? No, this is not enough. Vijay is giving much more than whatever we are getting from them, from whatever we are giving to Vijay. Okay. Similarly, we are around us, we have so many leaders also. We should learn from them. Also, like, how do they behave? How do the leaders behave? Like, whether they have a pleasing personality, or they are rude, or they don't care about the people's understanding. So that is what were the great traits of a leader. Sympathy, of course, you know, if you don't talk to people with sympathy, the followers will not follow you. Okay. And the next is like details. If all the leaders always go with the things in the detail. And the most important point I would say tell you is like assuming the full responsibility. If I'm leading a project, if I don't take the responsibility of the project, what is the loss, what is the income, whatever, like what I am delivering to the client. So wherever it is possible, I'll give a small example of whatever we had. The next slide I have, sorry. Okay, just one second. Okay, this is the one. What is happening?
Share it again, Chachi.
Yeah. Okay. This is the one I was talking about. You know, when Chandrayaan 2 happened, Abdul Kalam was telling about Abdul Kalam, or Dr. Abdul Kalam was telling about his failure about ISRO SLV 3 mission. Doctors, what is his name? I don't remember his name. His leader, okay, Sasidharan, I think Sasidharan Samad. So his leader, when Dr. Abdul Kalam failed in this mission, this SLB 3 mission, his leader took all the responsibility of the failure, okay? And he hired him, Abdul Kalam's fault or whatever it is, whatever the reason for the failure. But when the next year, then again, they worked on this and they successfully launched the vehicle, he asked Abdul Kalam, his leader asked Abdul Kalam to face the press person, to face the media, to tell about the success story. So this is a great example, I would say, like taking the full responsibility of failure. Okay, so whatever it is, if you are running a project, for running a team, always the leader need to take the responsibility of getting the failure. And the leader always like give the success to its subordinates or its followers many times. So this is again a great learning, and I'm almost done. The last point is about cooperation. Like without always like a leader always visualize the cooperation of their team. And sometimes the team could be the followers. And that is all about the 11 points I was trying to cover. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jiju. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Chachu. Wonderful topic. I think I'll just unshare it.
Yeah.
Yep. Great. I think the story of Satish Dhawan was there. I think Sanjeev.
Yes.
There was a very nice video also. I think press conference ka video bhi hai YouTube mein. If you just search it, it is amazingly good. You know, where he takes responsibility of the failure, and when it comes to success, he without any ego, he just gives everything to the people who have done for him. So it is amazing. Very nice story. In fact, very nicely related the point, Chachu. Thank you so much. So we'll quickly move to the next speaker. We have last one or two speakers left. So let me call my dad if he's available. Papa, you're available? Papa, can you hear me?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible, Papa. Go ahead.
Yeah. I think video is... I'll try to...
Go ahead.
Yeah, good evening to everybody. What I want to say, everybody want to become rich. And to become rich, we should have, as usual, should have desire rather the burning desire. If you have, it's a wish, there is without any plan, this without any plan, it becomes, doesn't become a desire, it becomes only wish. So to actually say, having the burning desire to achieve something, achieve some goal or to become rich, you should have burning desire. Now, today I'll share the story of Mr. Thomas Alva Edison, who has approved this sixth step of burning desire, I mean a sixth step of becoming rich, or sixth step of process to get rich or to achieve both. We will share the screen. Very young person, they should adopt this sort of method to become rich or to achieve goal, whatever they decided. Whatever they decide to acquire, they should decide this way. Don't be victim like me. I have never have the burning desire. See, simply you want to wish. Yeah, I will have 1 crore or 1 crore of money. I will have a Audi car or Benz car. It will not come. Only it is a wish. This will never get success in your life. Everybody, it is very easy to have a wish. Yes, I will achieve a Bangalore, I will achieve a car, I will have the 5 crore, 1 crore money. For that, you should have a desire, have burning desire. If you have burning desire, then definitely, friends, this will be on your way. It may be maybe less time, more time, but definitely you will achieve the goal. That was my thing. Thank you, Kiran.
Wonderful, Papa. It's really blessings to learn from this from you, because I think everyone is listening here right now. This is the first chapter of Think and Grow Rich, which is there in the syllabus designed by Vijay. Trust me, people can really apply and things will be wonderful. And there's no age, of course. You know, you see the live example in our book club. We have young people like Ishwar, Mahima, and till, you know, the age of my dad and, you know, whatnot. So we all come in between. So definitely we should apply a few things and really learn and help each other to grow to the fullest. Thank you so much, Papa, for sharing your topic. Great. So we move to the next speaker. I think Saurabh, we missed out. Saurabh, you want to go ahead and speak your topic as well? I'll take after you then. Quickly, you can go ahead in case you're prepared.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, good evening, everyone. So today, my topic is from the book Magic of Thinking Big. That is how to think big. So to become a big thinker, we must develop a big thinker's vocabulary. Big thinking is not like that. You should have big dreams. And you should not act on it, but we should have a big thinker's vocabulary. For that, we need to use a big, bright, and cheerful words that represent positiveness, happiness, pleasure. And we should avoid ourselves from the words or from the scenarios that gives us unpleasant image or talks of failure, defeat, grief. So we should avoid these sort of mentality or these sort of words. And develop this big thinker's vocabulary, first of all, we need to ask, what is our greatest weakness? Like, what is my greatest weakness? And with the human, the greatest weakness that we have is we really have a self-doubt in ourselves, or we really don't know our original worth. That is known as a self-deprecation. So we need to have doubt on ourselves, and we need to have a vision that should be stretched. Means what happens usually that people concentrate on the present scenarios and they don't look on the future outcome, the bigger picture, the bigger vision. So a very short example of this is there was a person who was a sales representative, and he was arguing with a customer for a 1 cent item. And his manager was saying him that he is arguing with his customer for a 1 cent item. And he was a very loyal customer. But after this argument happened, and the manager, he called in another person to evaluate that how valuable is the customer. And they know that the customers are very worthwhile, and they are spending round about more money. So for a cent, they lose a customer. So they just concentrated on a present situation, and they didn't look on the future outcome. So points that we need to develop a big thinker vocabulary. That is, we have to use a big, positive, cheerful words and phrases to describe how we feel. And we have to use positive language to encourage others, and have to use positive words to outline our plans. And we have to keep our eye focused on a very big objective, and have to ask question that the action that we are taking, is it really worthwhile? Is it really important? And in the end, to sum up, I would say to think big, we must use word and phrases which produce big positive mental energies. Thank you.
Very always, you know, I love Saurabh's talk. Every time crisp, within the timeline, covers all the points and ends the talk in a very nice note. Amazingly covered, Saurabh. In fact, my dad's continuation to Saurabh's topic. So I'll end this book club with a wonderful story, because after my dad spoke, Saurabh spoke, the biggest doubt which all of you will have to overcome yourself. And this is where I'll share about this Wonder Boy story. So Karthik, you can spotlight me. Awesome. So if you remember last book club, I was talking about a boy, right? He was a Wonder Boy. He was born in 1963 in the slums of Brooklyn, New York. Many people must be aware of who the boy is, but then, you know, most of you would not know. He had four siblings, and his father's earnings were not sufficient to provide for the whole family. He grew up in very, very poor neighborhood, exposed to mindless violence, heavy discrimination in slums, and he saw himself a hopeless future. And that was a time when, you know, he was going to give up in his life, and he went to his dad, and he was like lost soul. He went to his dad and told, "Dad, what do you think my future will be? I am actually don't know what to do in my life. I think we are done." And while his dad saw this boy so miserable, his dad went to his room, got out a small piece of cloth, and asked the boy, "What do you think the value of this outfit would be?" And the boy replied, "Maybe $1, or maybe maximum $1 or $2, that's all." Then his father asked, "Can you sell this cloth for $3? If you can sell it, it would mean that you are a big help to your family." Father gave a small purpose to the boy. And the boy told, "I'll try, Dad, but no guarantee that I'll be successful." So what does the boy does? He goes to his room, he washes the cloth, and they didn't have even iron to iron the clothes. So he leveled the clothes with a brush, and you know, he used gadda and all those stuff to flatten the cloth. And he went to a crowded underground station. वहां पे वो चिल्लाता रहा, he was just shouting about this cloth for almost 6 hours. He shouted, nobody came, and finally he managed the clothes to sell for only $2. He took the $2 bill and ran home. After that, every day he looked for used clothing, washed it, ironed it, and sold it in the crowd. So like that, he started making some income out of it. And after more than 10 days later, his father again gave him a piece of used clothing. And he asked, son, can you sell it for $20? And the boy was, how is that possible? This outfit can only fetch me $2 at the most. And the father told, why don't you try it, son? Ek baar try karke to dekho. There could be a way. And the son goes to his room. For an hour, he thinks, what can he do? What can he do about this cloth? And how can he, you know, sell it for $20? And suddenly an idea comes to his mind. And he thought of painting Donald Duck on that cloth and Mickey Mouse on the garment. So he paints that, again went to the underground area, could not sell there. Again, he went out. And while he was selling in the streets and all, he found a small school. And that is when a big businessman's housekeeper was taking a small boy to a school. And that housekeeper saw this beautiful cloth. And that housekeeper bought this beautiful cloth out of $25. And the boy was super, super happy. And the boy went again to his dad. And the moment he went to his dad, before he shared anything, his father gave another piece of clothing. And he told, son, can you resell it at a price of $200, the same cloth? And the boy was like, dad, are you crazy? What are you trying to do? This is not going to happen. He was about to give up. And then the dad told, why don't you give it a try, son? Just one more time. And this time the boy accepted the challenge. He went to his room again, started thinking, what could I do? And then took the cloth and was wandering in the streets and all. And at that time, a popular movie called Charlie's Angels was released. And the lady actress, Farrah Fawcett, was, you know, going around in the street nearby, was signing some signature in the press conference. And the boy slides to the crowd and then came out of it and screams to Farrah Fawcett to just give an autograph. And the lady saw this cute, innocent boy, goes to him, and then she gladly signs the autograph in the cloth. The moment that she signed, the boy was super, super excited. And he went outside and he started shouting, this cloth is signed with Miss Farrah Fawcett. I'm selling it for $200. And he kept on shouting until a businessman sees, and the businessman pays $1,200. Can you believe it? He sells that particular same cloth, which is just was for $1, for $1,200. And the moment he was returning home, he was completely happy. And his dad sees the boy, broke into tears. And he was like, I'm amazed that you did it, my child. You are really great. And that night, boy was sleeping with his father. And father asked, son, in your experience selling these three pieces of clothing, what did you learn about success? And you know what the boy replied? The boy replied, dad, where there is a will, there is a way. And his father nodded his head. He told, absolutely true. That is not entirely wrong, but that was not my intention. He told, I just wanted to show you that a piece of used clothing, which is worth only a dollar, can also be increased in value. And how about us, living and thinking humans? We may be darker or poor, but what if we can increase our value? So guys, the Wonder Boy, can anyone guess who the Wonder Boy is? Who knows the Wonder Boy? Kaun hai wo ladka? He is a real life guy. Can anyone share? Can anyone guess wildly? Who is that guy? Quick.
He's a player. I forgot the name.
Yeah, you're very close. I think Bhushan is very close. Anyone wants to get last guess? You all know him. Pardon? Somebody told something. Anyway, let me share. He's Michael Jordan. So Michael Jordan's, it's real story. And I hope you got some idea, because the kind of life he has gone through is terrible. I'm sure most of us have a many better life, many, many better situations we had. But only thing what he did is to never give up and to work on his value. And that is where this book club PIM comes into the picture. The story actually conveys it all, because until and unless we increase our thinking, we actually can't increase our value. So I hope it added a lot of value to all of you. And this was my topic for today. And we'll come up with a very interesting topic next.
So she told the-